Aloha, listeners, and welcome to another episode of the Cape and Cowcast, the podcast for everything Subaru and all that's awesome in between. I'm your host, Alex Burns, here, guys. So, hey, once again from me. This week, I'm joined with two regular members of Team Cape and Cow. You know them well. On my left, Mr. Stephen Carter.
Hello.
How you doing, buddy?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Oh, very well, thank you. And let's not forget about this guy, Mr. Sam Burns on my right.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm all right. Well, you've given me your bloody cold.
Well, if you've been listening to the previous podcast, which probably have, I'm feeling great. Got a little bit of sniffle, but Sam, not so good now.
Yeah, it's a guy from work. I've lost money because of you.
You'll be fine. You'll be fine. Dudes, it's our Doctor Strange special today. This episode, we're talking about nothing but Doctor Strange. It's the Halloween episode, so you know, naturally, we've gone with the theme of
magic.
Magic. And yeah, totally not connected. We're not quite prepared to do a theme podcast yet, but Doctor Strange is out, so really you shouldn't be talking about anything else. This is a movie out of nowhere, huh, Steve?
It was one of those ones where, again, we're thinking it might be another Ant-Man or something like that, where it might be one of the weak ones or so. Until we started seeing more photos and stuff like that, I was getting more and more excited about this. And my personal opinion, I think my views are justified.
Cool, man. I mean, of course, we'll be going into spoilerific detail, guys, so make sure you go and see the movie before you check this one out. It's out in the UK at the moment, so we got a bit of a head start on it, which is always awesome, but we know a lot of our listeners are from the United States, so happy for you guys to join in the conversation later. Certainly, I'm sure you won't spoil it for yourself anyway, but a little bit about us. We are the team that is Cape and Cow. If you're listening, you're listening to us on iTunes or Podbean or Stitcher. Thanks for listening. And make sure you subscribe for weekly podcasts coming at you about everything super, all that's magical in this instance as well. Check us out at capeandcow.co.uk. That's the place to start it all. News, articles, reviews, all kinds of stuff going on from myself, the rest of the guys here at Team Cape and Cow. You know what the deal is. You can also pick up some of our t-shirts as well. I'm wearing one today. I didn't get the Doctor Strange memo. These guys are wearing Doctor Strange t-shirts. And I'm a little old Cape and Cow. But I don't know, I think my t-shirt's kind of cool too. But anyway, you can check it out there, dudes. If you're watching, you're watching on YouTube. So hey guys, how you doing? Cape and Cow Unlimited. Like, subscribe, leave a comment, get involved in the chat. And if you want to talk to us, best place really is Twitter, at Team Cape and Cow. We love having messages with you guys about everything kind of superhero. Just movies, just general chat, dudes. Give us a like, give us a follow. We'll follow you back, providing you're not a robot or a douchebag. That's the spiel over. Doctor Strange, the spoilers begin now. What did everyone think? We'll start with you, Steve.
I thought it was a freaking awesome film. I don't know. It was just a really enjoyable thing from start to finish. Some people were saying about, you know, there was a bit of a lull in the middle. I didn't see it. The only slight gripe in it was, to be honest, is when they kept on sort of coming back to the hospital, really. It was like, you know, everyone gets a cut.
Yeah, so I mean, we'll get into specifics in terms of, like, we've got criticisms, but overall, you're like in awe of this film. Marvel have knocked it out of the park again for you.
It's definitely amongst my favourite films.
That is sure to not shock anyone that's been listening to our podcast, but it's worth mentioning. You know, this is a great film. We're all on board. That's the really brief review right there. We all had a great time going to see it, didn't we, Sam?
We did have a good time going to see it, but I've got slightly different views.
Okay, but you came out of it with a smile on your face, right?
I came out with a smile on my face, but I think Doctor Strange is a good film, cushioned by the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Okay, that's cool. So, all right, we'll get deeper into the criticisms to come, guys. We have to start on the overwhelming tide of positive reviews that this film is getting, because it's currently sitting at 98% on Rotten Tomatoes, which is you know, it is actually quite stupid, you know, and it just highlights how ridiculous Rotten Tomatoes is in and of itself, that it aggregates review scores. You know, a lot of outlets now don't even give review scores, so it's like, what is that being coming in at? You know, like, a lot of the reviews I've seen, like from some of the bigger outlets, aren't putting a star rating on there anymore. Like some people are being brave with these ratings now. They want you to actually read what they think of the film. Yeah. So, you know, there's not three capes and two cows here, guys. There's no kind of rating system. We'll just, you know, listen to our opinion and see if you want to give it a shake, see if you agree with us and all that. I really enjoyed Doctor Strange, and it was everything I expected it to be. I don't think I was particularly surprised by a lot of what I saw happen, because I'm used to Marvel. I'm used to the way they do their movies. It is formulaic at this point in times, but I think there was enough fantastical elements and trying something new, and it helped that Doctor Strange was such an out there character that he already differentiates himself from people like, you know, Ant-Man and some of the lesser known sort of characters we've seen adapted recently. He's very different in terms of his power set, in terms of his story and the world that he operates in. It's a world away from Iron Man and all the tech.
Yeah.
And Ant-Man and the science. It's more along the lines of the Thor movies, you know, if you are to compare it to anything else that Marvel have done. And it fits more in with Guardians of the Galaxy as well. So yeah, overall I'm chuffed with Doctor Strange, and I'd happily see it again. But let's get down to the leading man, Steve. Eggstia Benedict Cumberbatch. he's leading the line as Dr. Stephen Strange here.
Yeah.
How did he do?
It was a really good bit of casting, in my opinion. I mean, he certainly looks the part. I mean, it's got that sort of, you know, guy with, you know, slightly weird look about him, yeah. something otherworldly. And I personally think he should have actually kept his English accent.
Did it jar you, the American accent?
Certainly in trailers and things like that, it took a lot of getting used to.
Mm. What about you?
Well, with his accent, I don't really care, to be honest.
Yeah, I've heard a lot of things said about his accent, but I was just kind of, maybe I don't watch enough Benedict Cumberbatch movies.
It's a very sharp sort of American accent. It doesn't make, you know, the easiest to listen to.
I'm not going to do an impression. I was debating it in my mind.
The main thing is when he gets knocked into his astral form for the first time, That bit was uncomfortable to watch. It's just all the R's and everything like that. The way you pronounce the A's.
Really? Okay, maybe.
Because sort of I actually work at a cinema, so like a friend of mine, when we were working, he came out because he had to do like screen checks, and he was just like, I had to come out early because he was like, I can't do a Benedict's American. He's got a real issue with it. I don't know what it is, but I don't really. It doesn't take anything away from it. I mean, I think when you've got a film as visually as stunning as like Doctor Strange, and you're focusing on an American accent, I think you're watching and listening to the wrong stuff.
I really, really don't get that. But I you know, it's worth mentioning, dudes, because a lot of people have an issue with this. His accent. I've seen it. It's coming up. It's like, you know, you look at sort of snips of the hashtag Doctor Strange, what's going on there, and you're sort of getting a vibe for what people think, and that keeps coming up.
I'm surprised with the revelation that it's coming up. It's almost like Russell Crowe's accent in Robin Hood. And everything like he got really ticked off of that. Whenever someone mentioned that in an interview, he would
the Ridley Scott Robin Hood, yeah.
He would just storm off, sort of thing. He would get in real huff about it. But I don't think
I think you can compare it. I didn't really enjoy that Robin Hood movie, but you know, it's one of those things. I think Benedict Cumberbatch sounds like he's American.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think there's a big problem over here because, you know, in the UK especially, it's like. Maybe you notice when someone's putting on an accent more, but I find some of the British voices done by British actors in like some of our own stuff. Like, I've got to say, I don't like mentioning this. It's the other Doctor, Doctor Who. I don't like mentioning it, but whenever I've been forced or subjected to watch this, I'm just like, why are there English people putting on English accents in this thing? And I don't know if it's sort of doing that sort of same sort of thing, because you used to watching Benedict Cumberbatch in stuff like Sherlock.
Yeah,
you know, obviously that's the big thing over here, and I know that's big BBC America now as well. So maybe that's the thing. And he's so renowned for being that English accent.
There's even things like when he played Khan in the remake of Star Trek. You know, that was British. He was a British accent in that one as well, wasn't it?
Do you know what? I actually liked Into Darkness, and I cannot for the life of me remember how he talks in it.
You know what I think it is? I think we're just quite possessive of things in the UK, and we're subjected to so much, like so much American media, that I think when someone strays over and like kind of meshes the two together,
you're not allowed.
Funny, yeah. I think that's something like that, because he's so well regarded by people as well. He's one of our own. I think they just didn't like it.
I think the funny thing is that when people like Andrew Garfield as well, when he took over the role of Spider-Man, that was actually done well, in my opinion. I didn't notice that as much. I don't know if it's because we haven't really seen Garfield in much else apart from, like, you know, The Social Network.
Maybe it is that. He's so renowned for being the British dude in all these sort of films, and he's always, whether he's a dragon or, you know, whatever. Yeah. But, you know, I think we've covered his accent.
Yeah,
that's quite the hot topic, really. Yeah. And, yeah, I thought you did a great job. I think you're right, Steve, he looks the part. But also, you know, it's worth mentioning, an actor of this pedigree, and also the rest of the cast involved in this film, you've got some amazing talent. Tilda Swinton, Chiwetel Ejiofor as well. Yeah. These are all sort of like award-winning
Mads
actors.
Mads Mikkelsen as well.
Mads Mikkelsen coming in there. Rachel McAdams. Yeah. You know, this is a fantastic cast they've lined up. And, I know you guys gave me some shit for comparing it to Batman Begins from the outset. Like, oh, you know, other heroes are allowed to go to Tibet and train in the monasteries and all that sort of jazz. But I got some Begins vibes, and I'm not saying they were influenced, but the whole sort of production, kind of a kooky concept taken very seriously, because Batman's an equally nuts thing. The dude dressed like a bat, he's a regular guy, so it's the opposite sort of end of the spectrum, whereas Doctor Strange is the complete other way. Everything's possible, you know, like nothing's stupid or anything like that. And I felt they did a really good job. And also the cast, Batman Begins, they surrounded sort of Christian Bale with Morgan Freeman, Gary Oldman, Michael Caine, and it really reminded me of this. The Marvel movies have always done a good job of getting that great cast, but I think on paper, this is probably the most accomplished cast list they've had in terms of people who are already pre-established and haven't since become more famous because they're in Marvel movies, you know, Robert Downey Jr. sort of being the exception. But yeah, damn, this is a good film. Damn, the cast is amazing. I don't think there's actually any weak link in terms of performance, maybe what they're given in the movie, but overall it's a very strong cast.
Yeah, I think the only thing you could argue with having a stellar cast of that magnitude is that, you know, underuse of some characters. Like, you know, why would you have this, like, Oscar-winning actress for, you know, such a minor role and stuff like that? Well, you know, if they wanted that role in
it's a cliche criticism, I feel. It's just like, oh, what a waste of a wonderful actress. It's like, well, no, they, you know, got their payday and they did a great job in the role that serviced the story. You know, so I thought it was great. But Benedict Cumberbatch, he's great. He starts off and he's Dr. Stephen Strange at the height of his game. So it's worth getting into sort of like the establishment, the establishing sort of arc for this character, Steve. How do you feel Marvel did in establishing Dr. Stephen Strange before he becomes Sorcerer?
They did it very, very efficiently. I'm pretty sure we were subjected to the accident like well within the first 15 minutes, weren't we? But to be honest, I think that's all you can do. You know, he's a master surgeon. And he knows it.
Surgeon Supreme,
yes. And obviously, yeah, he's well aware of his reputation going through, and he's, you know, amazingly arrogant when it comes to it. Like, you know, he's borderline, well, he is unlikable at the, you know, the first stage of the film, isn't he? I think that's the whole, you know, point of sort of, you know, getting to know this character anyway.
Yeah.
And yeah, like I said before, you don't... it's not long before you see him in his crash, in his life-changing sort of accident.
Yeah.
The way you see his hands just disappear into the dashboard.
Yeah, it's like they're about to get crushed.
Yeah,
quite an impressive car crash. And I will say the build-up to that drive.
Squeaky bum time, wasn't it? Because you knew it was going to happen.
Squeaky bum time.
Because it was quite uncomfortable, to be fair.
And I applaud them for doing it that early, because they were just like, let's tell this story. And I do think they, Marvel, they were sort of like, this could get formulaic. We don't want this arc of him becoming a hero midway through the film.
Exactly. There's a lot of this whole thing about, you know, most superheroes are just characters outside of their shelves for a long time. That was the biggest criticism of the Dark Knight trilogy, was, you know, how little time he was in the suit. And I think honest, like, you know, for at least, like, you know, three quarters of the film, he is Strange.
Yeah, he's Doctor Strange, man. He's flipping it around. And I think that was a great sort of distinction they made, because he was always, even in terms of, like, when he eventually starts training in Tibet or whatever it is, he doesn't become someone else. He's always Stephen Strange. He's just developing as a character, as opposed to putting on a mask to become someone else.
Exactly, it's not an alter ego anymore.
I really, really like that. You know, he's, you know, I am Doctor Strange, he says later on in the film, and I think they did a great job. I actually didn't have a problem with him as the arrogant sort of surgeon. I mean, I know he was sort of a douchebag, and in terms of, like, I just, you know, he was a successful, really smart dude, and you can't really blame him. You know, he was just at the height of his game, and he does, let's remind everyone, he saves someone off of an ER desk, like
that
a bullet
was a really
from their
cool
brain.
That was
someone
nice
who was,
yeah, cool,
he
yeah.
was already like acting above and beyond. So I actually feel that this is a little bit of a criticism of a film. I don't think his arc is particularly powerful compared to the other Marvel heroes, like Iron Man. Tony really learning the humility about like where his money comes from, where his wealth,
and
deciding,
well,
deciding, hey, I don't want to be part of war profiteering or anything like that. Doctor Strange, his arc is basically realizing the greater good, but he was kind of already part of the greater good, but he wanted to be known for it. I think that was the difference. Wasn't it?
Yeah, but that's like putting the two against each other. Like he was, like you were saying, he's part of the greater good, but he was doing it completely selfishly.
Yeah.
He like he could cure cancer and he wouldn't care about the millions of people that would be saved from it. It would be his name forever embedded in history. Whereas what you got later on in the film, which is when, which is what I really liked, when he's like he's in like the monastery and stuff and he's learning and he's humbled for a while because he understands, he doesn't understand anything that's going on. He starts reading the books, he starts getting his knowledge and he starts to have that arrogance again, and that's what I liked about it.
The knowledge is
power. Yeah, knowledge is power, and that like he can be humble and he can, you know, be brought back down to earth in a certain extent. But I want Doctor Strange to be this kind of douchebag character. You know what I mean? So that's what I like most about like his character.
I completely agree. Yeah, it's just the whole humility thing. Yeah, but you do get a sense of that sort of towards the film anyway when he's really struggling with the practices. He gets abandoned on the top of Mount Everest for a time as well.
Yeah, I mean, so let's get into, so after the crash, he has his hands, and I actually think they handled him well. He has just these hands that can't do anything. And I love that his immediate reaction is, "You idiots!
Yeah,
you've saved my life, but you've ruined my career."
And there's,
you know?
And there's a great bit because his like mouth is stitched as well.
Yeah,
and what's her name? Dr. Palmer, Rachel McAdams' character. Just says there's nothing else they could have done, and he was like, I could have done better. Yeah, I could have done better, and it is just so.
But it's probably. You know what I mean? Like it's sort of like that thing. But I thought they handled it well, and I really like the fallout because he gets lines that you just don't give a hero. You know, where he basically, it's that apartment scene where, you know, we coined this actually. I don't think we coined, you know, and when we were speculating about Doctor Strange, we were like, he's going to sell all his watches. we had a little joke because he has the spinning watch drawer and it's just like he's going to search the world, exhaust all of the resources, and lo and behold, the dude, the watch is a plot point, man. His last watch, the one that he holds onto that he doesn't want to sell. He even puts it on at the end of the movie.
Yeah.
That's a Capon Cow tip right there, guys. This is why I listen to this podcast, for insight like that. I was actually grinning ear to ear in the cinema.
The Capon Cow forecast.
There you go.
The cassette tape. Yeah. Doctor Strange has a broken watch.
Yeah, exactly. There's always that cool little item. And I love it. But I love the way in that apartment scene where all of his stuff's gone, compare it to 5 minutes earlier. He's walking around, he's got a piano there and all these vases and vases and whatever, and he's driving, and then his crazy little amazing car comes out and all that jazz, and then in the 5 minutes later after the accident, after the fallout, he's there with nothing in his apartment, just a list, and you know, trying to resource.
It's essentially a montage of how it gets poorer.
It's brilliant. And you know, the shit he says to Rachel McAdams' character as well, just it's like, screw you, and it's like, we were barely lovers, you know. It's just like, it's so mean.
Yeah, because he says to her, it's just like, you're interested in me now again
because I'm a sob story. You're gonna save me,
and you get to pity me.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that was really, really cool.
It was gripping, and I was investing. And I actually think Rachel McAdams, you know, it's that common criticism, she was underserved by the script, all that sort of blah blah, because she was one of the more interesting human leads that we've had. She wasn't an Natalie Portman in Thor, which just sort of like, what is even going on with this character?
Yeah, exactly.
Do you know what I mean? First person Thor meet sort of thing. At least they had some history, the two of them. So I like that. Did she feel the bill for you? Were you weren't bored when she came on? Or did you find those hospital scenes a bit of a drag when they turned up?
No, like I say, it just annoyed me, the fact that they kept on turning, you know, coming back to the hospital sort of thing. But then, I think it's just the situation they need, you know, they needed to find sort of something to do with Rachel.
She lives at the hospital.
She never goes.
That was the longest shift, man. Like, it was almost comical because when he turns up with Tilda Swinton, the ancient one at the end, it was like, it's like the third or fourth body he's brought her in this movie. It was just kind of ridiculous. But he also brings his own body as well, which is just kind of funny. But no, I love it. I mean, he gets to the monastery. We see these awesome sequences. This is what I loved about this movie, the global aspect. Take me around the world with these heroes, man. Make me feel like it's the real world. The Marvel Universe is full on established. And here he is, man. He's bearded. He's got no money. He's getting mugged in this dark alleyway in Tibet. I'm feeling it. At this point, I'm just like, this is why these Marvel movies work, man. Because this is a Raiders of the Lost Ark type adventure that just surprises audiences.
Yeah.
Because as much as we know already about Doctor Strange, I was just in that moment. I was like, I'm sitting in the theater and, whoa, this dude's just like on this quest. This is an adventure movie. Before it's anything else, it just works so well. You're already halfway across the globe. You know, it's wonderful. Oh, I love it. It was great.
And it's the whole take it up a notch. So it's not just the globe, it's the multiverse.
Yes.
That we get introduced to. There you go, man. So that was the big visual spectacular for that, you know, 10 minutes or so, wasn't it?
That was the best scene in the movie.
Mm.
Yeah, that.
Yeah. Are we all in agreement? Like,
that's the one thing I'm looking forward to when I get to see an HD sort of, you know, at home.
Oh, beautiful. Just sort
like,
of
just
on
all
repeat.
The colours and everything.
So
like,
this is when, you know, Steve Ditko, his artwork.
This is
when it comes to life, you know, and it's this amazing sequence, isn't it, Sam?
Oh, it's freaking trippy, man. Like, you don't even need to take anything. Like, it's just one of the most visually spectacular bits of probably filmography. Like, it's like,
it did look like something out of a Beatles film.
Yeah,
you know,
it was crazy.
Cover.
It was beautiful. Yeah. I cannot give the visual effects team enough credit in this movie, and I don't know anything like about like blending effects or, you know, how, you know, you can pull a little space into more space. I don't know how difficult that is. There might be some tech guff sort of scoffing, like, oh, well, it's really easy. You know, that, like, it looks like, you know, like, if you want to be a dick, someone literally just put all the effects in Photoshop on one sort of piece of... it's just like, everything, man, yeah, we'll go charcoal, then we'll go distort, and then we'll go... But it was amazing. It was the trippiest trip of all time.
I'll tell you
it was
what,
unbelievable.
Like, in Ant-Man, when he goes in the space between spaces, that's a really cool visually good bit as well, but it made that kind of look quite
pedestrian. There was one particular bit that did look very similar to that.
I was thinking that as well. I'm pretty sure he did explore
the microverse.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be great if you were zooming past it, you just saw Ant-Man?
That'd
be quite funny.
Like, hey,
there we go. You know what? He's probably in there somewhere. Yeah, I bet there's so many little hidden Easter eggs in that sequence, and it was unbelievable, man. It's like when you fly, it's like, you know, you get those ideas of sort of like, if you could just fly into space, what would happen?
Mm.
You know, if you got right just to the edge, you know, and it's just like, you might hit a brick wall and then go through an ocean, you know, and it's just sort of, it was unbelievable. So the Ancient One takes, you know, Doctor Strange's arrogance about, like, you know, it's great the way that scene plays out. He's like, what, hippies, gurus? Yeah, I saw that poster in like a coffee shop or whatever it is.
And, oh yeah,
you know, I love it. It was perfect. And, you know, she's great when you bring the Ancient One in. Tilda Swinton, she was really cool.
Yeah, she was. Tilda Swinton, she there was a lot of stick for, you know, her casting in the first place, because you know, in the comics, you know, the genders are swapped.
Doesn't really look like Tilda Swinton.
Yeah, Tilda Swinton doesn't really look like an ancient Tibetan man. Yeah. So,
well,
it's called acting, Steve.
But no.
No, I'm joking.
Great, like the whole look. I mean, the fact that she shaved her head and she's got the crazy scars and everything. It just completes the look, really, sort of otherworldly, and it's when we start to get to see the humour in that film as well.
Yeah,
like when he when Doctor Strange finally comes back, and he's like, "Teach me,"
kicks out the door. It was very Yoda-esque, wasn't it? Yeah. Sort of thing. And I really like the way they did that. And
it's just where we're treated to all the humour of that, and, you know, when he finally gets let in.
Yeah.
So it's like just leaning against the door and it just suddenly opens back and you just hear this whimpering, thank you.
Yeah. I mean, it's a Marvel script, so there are the obligatory jokes. You can almost sort of count them. You could watch your timepiece go around, you know, providing it's not one of the strangers. Yeah. And you'd be like, ding, ding, every sort of 30 seconds or whatever. But, you know, hey, keeps everyone smiling. That's the important thing.
I think my main concern was that, you know, whether it's going to start looking out of place, like in the second Thor, the Dark World.
Yeah.
That, to be honest, should have been a lot more serious than it was. But there was a lot of sort of unwelcome, almost forced sort of bits of humour into that. But this worked.
This almost is a template for what you're what you should be doing with Thor movies.
Mm.
You know, and It really reminded me stylistically of the Guardians. I mean, especially the space sequences. They've done a good job of, you know, as much as they were, you know, in touch with those sort of old 60s comic books, there's the Steve Ditko art style from those originals. they blended it. So if you put a shot in Doctor Strange in those interdimensions and maybe put a shot of Star-Lord and Gamora next to each other listening to the Walkman out on that big head of that planet, do you remember? Wherever it was in Guardians, those two shots would look very similar. So I like it. I like the vivid purples, the crazy greens that are coming out there, and it's just a beautiful film to watch. I cannot wait to watch it again. I'm really excited. I'm super excited to just absorb all of the, because it's a film where I'd say the majority of the budget's gone on design, concept. Know what I mean? Like, and we'll come to the other action spectacles after we get into Chiwetel Ejiofor's character, Baron Mordo. Sam, what was the deal, Dan? How did you feel about him also coming in, not as a villain, but as a...
Well, his introduction to the film was probably the best possible way. He sees Doctor Strange, he sees Stephen Strange just like walking through wherever it was in Tibet, looking for like the sanctuary, and so he just decides to tail him, and Strange goes down an alleyway and gets mugged, and he saves him in a really badass way. He just kicks the crap out of these like thugs and takes him to the sanctuary.
Couldn't save the watch, so
couldn't save the watch was already broken, weren't it?
Yeah, in the mugging.
It got broken in the mugging.
No, it didn't. It was the one he had in the car crash.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, because it's the one that was broken.
Okay,
it's the watch he kept because it had inscribed on it from Rachel McAdams' character.
There we go then.
Okay, all right, yeah, cool. Yeah. Dude, we totally missed that.
Well, I wasn't watching the film, obviously.
But yeah, no, his introduction was really good, and when he starts training with Doctor Strange, it's really cool. But not to get too ahead of myself, as the film went on, I wanted a lot more from him. And that's one of the problems I had with this film, that there were like two characters in particular who I wanted a lot more from. And I didn't really get it, but he was really cool to start with. And I wanted that whole thing we talked about before, where it was like a buddy cop kind of thing. You know what I mean? Like, where him and Strange were just fighting the world together. It was like, you know, it was... That's what I kind of wanted. I didn't really get that in the end, but...
I liked the way that, you know, the relationship between the two actors. I think they had great chemistry, you know, and there wasn't this rivalry that I thought there might be, considering their comic history.
There's hints of it. I mean, especially towards the end.
Yeah.
It seemed to be, I think, with Baron Mordo's story, it seemed to be sort of, you know, it was just a subplot for the next film.
He was a true believer in the ways of the Ancient One, you know, and the big reveal of, you know, the fact that the Ancient One was tapping into the power of Dormammu to stay alive. That was the big switch, you know?
So. I remember when he first got announced as Baron Mordo as well. I think that was when everyone sort of thought, right, okay, this guy's going to be the big bad then. Baron Mordo's like the bad guy.
Fantastic actor as well. You just think and he could do it. Right,
I think they're going to play Baron Mordo as more of a rival rather than, you know, just someone like, who could we say, sort of like Sinestro or something like that, where he's just like, you know, I'm evil because I like being evil sort of thing. But it's like a conflict of opinions. Yeah. I think they were hinting that in the films, but yeah, we'll go. That's another time. But it does seem like they're going like that. But yeah, I agree with you with the underuse of his character, in particular, anyway. I just think that it was just a prelude to
Doctor
Strange. Because it was really good to start with, because you got time with him and Strange, and then he kind of went missing for a while, got a little bit annoyed and frustrated at what was going on, then decided in the end that he was just, you know, he was balls to the walls crazy. It was just sort of stepping stone alligator.
We'll get onto the Easter eggs at the end of the podcast. But by and large, his role in the film, I think he serviced it well. He was a foil to sort of get Strange to take things seriously and to obviously teach him, you know. And then we come to probably the best really sort of collection of scenes in the film, which is the sort of, I want to call it a montage, but it's not. I was happy with his training at the monastery or the... What is it actually called? What's the name of the place? It's bugging me. He's walking through the streets and he's like, Cambush.
You look... You Cambusha. And I'll have a quick...
Cambusha. But anyway, this montage sequence, I was just like...
I'll say Shambhala, but that's...
No, that's the Wi-Fi password, Sam. Yeah. It's the Wi-Fi password. Steve, you should know this like this, man. Mr. Stephen Strange is not even remembering where you took your training, Steve. But I like the way it played out. I wanted that. I kind of, you know, montages, like, you can take the mick out of them, but they work. And I feel like, you know, even Rocky had a montage, you know. Rocky has several montages. But, like, you just had to, it was stretched out. They did it in a similar way to Begins, when he's training in the monastery. They sort of spread it out over flashbacks and things like that. This one interspersed with Stephen Strange's interactions with Wong, Benedict Wong.
Starring as himself.
Can I just get it off my chest?
It's hilarious.
Benedict Cumberbatch, Benedict Wong. Wong! It's just a wonderful chain of sequence of characters. I just love it. Anyway, Wong was great. He was hilarious. I loved him. He was so good.
It says here, by the way, Kathmandu, Nepal. That's apparently where it starts off.
Kathmandu.
Kathmandu. And there's a name for the sanctuary as well, which I can't find.
That's the one I want to know.
Yeah, well, I'm trying to find it.
Yeah.
Anyway,
the montage, man. So they interspersed it with, you know, instead of flashbacks of sort of the past, this one was interspersed with Doctor Strange's reading habits, you know, going to the library and studying. And I like the way they did that. I feel after you had the sequence where he flew through all the dimensions and his mind was absolutely blown, that he took things in his stride a bit too much. And they didn't really convey the passage of time, because we already know from the director, Scott Derrickson, he said that the training goes on for about a year.
Yeah.
It's not really conveyed in the movie, the time frame there, and that kind of irritates me, because a year is a long time for Cassilius, who we'll get onto later, to not be doing anything, considering how quickly he was moving at the start of the film.
True,
so that's a bit of an issue for me. I feel it could have benefited from also a little bit of an issue where Strange had one thing that he couldn't do during training that he used later on that he would use later on at the end of the film.
Yeah.
So you always have that forward, don't you? Like at the beginning of Batman Begins, you have, you never learn to mind your surroundings, you know?
Yeah.
At the end, he does mind his surroundings. So I feel Strange needed that just at the end. He learned humility and all that. That was his big transition. But I felt Mordo maybe should have kept kicking him down. There could have been a lot more where he could never beat Mordo in a fight, then all of a sudden he did one training session, you know, because it escalates after the montage. All of a sudden he's fighting Cassilius, and that was a bit of a stretch for me, because I just thought there's no way he's winning this fight.
It was a bit of a jump. It was going to be his first meeting.
Yeah.
Because obviously, you know, spells are still not going quite right and everything like that. He just managed to hold his own. And I think it seemed to be more, you know, thinking outside the box that got him through that fight.
True.
I think
He didn't really rely on magic. He relied on things that he was surrounded. He used the sanctum.
He minded his surroundings.
He's the head of a Batman!
Sanctum Sanctorum.
Yes.
That's what it's called.
Yep, that's the New York one. That was amazing. That was absolutely amazing.
Oh yeah, you talk about the houses like the three
sanctums.
Sanctums. But that one's called Sanctum.
New York, Hong Kong, and London. Notice London gets done first. Bit of rubbish, obviously.
That's where all the action is.
Obviously, Harry Potter wasn't doing his job very well.
Where was Harry during all this? Freaking awkward.
Yeah, but I loved it, and that was my montage. How did you feel about the training sequence?
I really, really liked it, but I agree with you. I thought there should have been like a spell that Strange couldn't have blocked, and like he just couldn't ever, you know, like repair.
It's like a cliche, you know.
Yeah,
I was waiting for that Rocky moment where he finally runs up the last step. You know what I mean? Like, and he finally catches the chicken, you know, that Mickey let out. You know, just something for the teleport was a good sequence.
Yeah, I think this is the thing though. I think they even said this at the film, that we're only going to see like a very brief outline of what Strange can do. And I that's what I got at the end of it, that he's not even Sorcerer Supreme or anything like that. He hasn't gained that title. He's just, you know, survived the first onslaught sort of thing. And he's just managed to seek a temporary truce with Dormammu. And it's just one of those. I think that that's what this is what I'm trying to get across now. Yeah, we are just getting the bare essential Doctor Strange.
Yeah,
here.
I know.
Yeah, but I'm allowed to be picky because Marvel have set their standards so high, Steve.
Yeah,
so.
No, but this is what I mean though, that it's being reinforced by the MCU. Like, you've got a massive plot hole here, where in the beginning of the film starts off with Caecilius basically holding his own against the Ancient One and doing her over a little bit.
Yeah,
you know. Then you've got Doctor Strange, who completely fucks him over. You know, and you've just said, well, he can't really do anything at the minute. That's what I'm saying. Like, you've got like the Sorcerer Supreme and Doctor Strange, who can barely use his hands doing magic.
Out that you don't actually, it doesn't matter about his hands.
Oh yeah, I know, but you know what I'm saying.
No, that
what I say makes
it was
sense.
It was his intellect and thinking that got him through that film, not his ability. because if you think about it, it was Eye of Agamotto that he happened to come across, and he was like experimenting with its time bending things. That's how he managed to sort of, you know, get through the film.
And the Cloak of Levitation, which won him the fight.
Yeah,
because let's not forget, you say it was his intellect that was going to win him. He was going to go for the axe, and the cloak dragged him back to get that cage.
Yeah, no, that's what, he had help. I appreciate that. I was like, dude, you're being stupid. Use this thing to chain him up and get him in that contraption, which I'm not quite sure. It's kind of weird, but anyway, it was cool.
It was a supreme.
But it's worth mentioning.
Since this is what, 50 Shades of Grey.
Let's get onto the gadgets, though, man, because, you know, this was a film that, you know, it had magic, it had it, but I like the way it sort of, as you say, Steve, it scaled down. It's like, yeah, magic, you're thinking, oh, well, you can do anything, you know, so you can't just Sabrina the Teenage Witch this. You've got to sort of give it some rules and some stuff. So the sling ring, I thought that was a nice sort of object. You had to have it on if you wanted to do the teleportation. Also, the chains were amazing as well, sort of when they were pulled the energy and could do themselves. Also, the there were a few weapons, weren't there, that you could channel.
Yeah, Barrymore was explained to him.
This is the big one. This is the big one, guys. I've just had to remember the name. But it's the Living Tribunal, Steve.
Right.
And this is actually like the Living Tribunal. Barrymore shows it to Doctor Strange during the training. He's like, some magic's way too powerful, so we have to use, you know, an object to sort of harness and channel the magic. And the Living Tribunal, I was like, why do I recognise this dude? He's that tall, freaking massive universe. Like, there's a picture of him with three heads.
Yeah.
You know, we'll show a picture to the guys on the video and stuff. He's a, you know, he's basically someone that comes in whenever there's a universal mind bending interdimensional problem in the MCU. That's the dude that sort of turns up, you know.
See, whenever you say describe that, I'm thinking of the Watcher, but that's not it.
No, but I mean, he looks so familiar. I swear he turned up in the crossover between DC and Marvel, you know, that big fight
before.
I swear he's one of the dudes in that. But anyway, the fact is, Living Tribunal, that's a big, like, they're addressing these interdimensional characters now. And, you know, hopefully that won't be, maybe it's just a nod, but I thought that was a nice little Easter egg.
Yeah, but also, Barrymore, when he's, like, when he's training Strange a little bit as well, he has those boots as well. Do you know what they're called?
The vaulting boots of something. Yeah. It just rolls off the tongue, as they say.
But like, you see him like bounce through the air and just crack Strange.
Yeah, I thought that was
and
awesome.
And when I was watching that, I was like, because I knew that Barrymore was eventually going to fall from grace.
Yeah,
I was watching that, I was like, that's going to be a good fight. Mm. That's going to be a really
good fight. He's like, fight as your life depends on it, you know.
And he's got like all these, like, he's got the Eye of
Agamotto.
Imagine how like Strange is having that and like his cloak against this dude which has got these like thumping weapons.
Yeah, I just thought it was brilliant.
And apparently what was it called, the Living Tribunal, what you were talking about, apparently that kicks the shit out of the Infinity Gauntlet. Apparently the power
of the Living Tribunal is beyond. So maybe not if it can be channeled into a stick. You know, I'm sure the Infinity Gauntlet is going to wrap things up quite nice and tidy.
Wouldn't that be funny if like you just get where Thanos is about to kill everyone?
Yeah.
Then Barrymore comes out of this, he's like, I fucking yeah.